took this picture, they noticed this one woman who was standing out. Her face was tilted in the most odd way, creeping everybody who saw it out. We all know that normal people do not take pictures like this at all. She almost looked possessed in this photo. But then people noticed, oh, somebody just edited out the picture and made it look that creepy. Well, here's the normal photo. Believe it or not, majority of the people who seen this photo still was creeped out by the normal looking photo, because if you look deeper into her eyes, if you just look deeper and deeper into her, she just still looks creepy.
It's really hard for me to wrap my mind around the fact that this horrific case is still unsolved. 6 years later, 17-year-old Maggie Long was a senior at Platte Canyon High School in Colorado. On December 1st, 2017, her school was hosting a concert that Maggie helped organize. She left the school around 3:30 p.m. to go home and pick up snacks for the audience and get a change of clothes. Maggie was supposed to be back within an hour or so, but she never returned. 3.5 hours after Maggie left the school, a 911 call is placed by the tenants living in the Long family's attic. They said there were people downstairs in the house arguing, throwing things, and trying to set the house on fire. The caller knew that there was a violent situation going on and they didn't feel safe to go downstairs. EMS arrived at the scene within 10 minutes, and after putting out the fire, they found the remains of Maggie Long. At least 3 men and possibly a 4th was involved. Police believe Maggie returned home while the suspects were inside. Maggie was apparently overpowered and tied to a bed. They proceeded to steal jade figurines, a green safe, a 9mm handgun, an AK-47 style rifle, and 2,000 rounds of ammunition. Before they fled, they set Maggie on fire, burning her alive. Because the family's ranch was off a secluded road and there was only one way in and one way out, it's very possible that EMS passed the suspects on their way in. There is now a $75,000 reward for information about Maggie's murder. You can also send information anonymously through this tip line or email.
All right, guys, we're going to be talking about a true crime fan who was recently convicted of murder after stabbing her victim over 100 times. She said she just wanted to know what it felt like, which brings up a bigger question. In true crime, we want to educate, we want to inform, but are we contributing to this problem? We're going to bring on forensic psychologist John Delatorre to break it all down. Join us Wednesday night on Crime Feed.
The wife of a plastic surgeon in Florida died after undergoing several procedures at her husband's office, and now her death is being investigated. November 21st, 33-year-old Hillary Brown was receiving procedures from her husband, Dr. Ben Brown, at his office at Restore Plastic Surgery in Gulf Breeze, Florida. During the procedures, she ended up seizing and going into cardiac arrest and then fell into a coma. She remained in the coma for a week until she was taken off life support because she had gone without oxygen to her brain for too long. And now, the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office is investigating her death. So let's talk about what happened. Hillary had 3 children from a previous marriage and has been married to Ben Brown for about 2 years. Dr. Ben Brown is a practicing plastic surgeon in Florida, but he has a history of malpractice lawsuits against him. His practice, Restore Plastic Surgery, currently has 2 malpractice lawsuits open against it. Only one lists him as the defendant, though, and it is still ongoing. The plaintiffs in this case, Wendy and William Cardin, allege that Brown used foreign materials in a post-mastectomy reconstructive breast surgery for Wendy without her consent back in 2018, and that this caused infection and sepsis at the surgery site. The lawsuit also claims that Wendy suffered nerve damage and other permanent injury due to the extension and position of her arms during the prolonged surgery, alleging that Brown, quote, negligently failed to periodically monitor the position of the upper extremities. Brown is currently facing that malpractice lawsuit, but he now may be facing more serious charges depending on the result of the investigation into his wife's death. At 4:15 p.m. on November 21st, Ben Brown called 911 from the Restore Plastic Surgery office. The notes from the call indicate, quote, a female patient was in cardiac arrest after potentially being over-medicated. Hillary's father, Marty Ellington, said that Brown told him that he was out of the medication they typically use, so he used something different for her surgeries. There are questions about that and also questions about the presence of other medical personnel during the surgeries. November 24th, 3 days after the surgeries, Ben Brown posted on social media, quote, we need prayers for a miracle. Hillary had a cardiac arrest on Tuesday afternoon. He wrote, we called 911 and started CPR. Her heart came back, but her brain is not doing well. Hillary Ellington Brown, you are my soulmate, my world, my everything. Please come back. please. A statement provided by a PR firm on behalf of Ben Brown's family said Ben was performing minor and routine services on Hillary. It also said that all medical protocols were followed and additional medical staff were present at the time of the procedures. The death is being investigated because, according to Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office spokesperson Jill Durkin, any time a death is unexpected or occurs under unusual circumstances, they investigate. Durkin said the cause and manner of death is pending the receipt of the autopsy protocol from the District 1 Medical Examiner's Office. The autopsy protocol typically takes several months, as it usually is dependent on extensive laboratory and toxicology tests, as well as the information gathered by our major crimes detectives concerning the circumstances of the death. Hillary's parents, Marty and Dixie Ellington, said that she was full of fire and energy since she was a girl, and they just want answers about what happened to their daughter. Marty said, "We want answers. We haven't been given answers. If it's a mistake, it was a mistake, but it doesn't bring my daughter back. I don't want his money. I don't want anything. All I want is an answer because I think that we owe that to my daughter." The investigation will likely take a few months, and like Marty said, if it was a mistake, then it was a mistake. But because it was an extremely unexpected death during this medical procedure, it is being investigated. And hopefully the truth about what happens will come out. Rest in peace, Hillary.
A mother pushed her child on a swing for over 40 hours until he died. This is the tragic story of Ramisha Sims and her poor little son, Jayeli. It was May of 2015 when Ramisha would take her little boy, her little three-year-old son, to the park as they would normally go. This time something was different. Ramisha had been off her schizophrenia medication for a few days now, and when she took her son to the park, no one knew that she was in the middle of a psychotic break, so she put her child inside the swing and started pushing him. More and more hours passed by, and poor little Jaya was just in the swing, helpless. He couldn't get out, and his mum was almost in some sort of daze. She was in such a psychotic state, and she ended up being there throughout the entire night and the next day for 44 hours, until finally poor little Jaya passed away. He passed away in the swing due to hypothermia and dehydration. She stood in the same spot for all those hours pushing him. Like, you can imagine how frightened he was and how uncomfortable and cold, how much pain and discomfort he was in. And it's just one of the most tragic stories I've ever heard. So obviously help eventually came. There was a few people that say that they did in fact see her, but they just thought that she was going or coming back. So eventually when it was reported and the news broke to the family, everyone was devastated, as you can imagine, especially Jaya's father, as he had even requested full custody of him not long before this incident, because he knew that the mother's mental state wasn't good enough to look after him. But while all that was being sorted out, Ramisha decided to stop taking her schizophrenia medication that she had been taking for all this while, and these were the harmful consequences to her actions that day. It went to court, obviously, and she was found not guilty because she was in the middle of psychosis, but she now has to attend counseling and therapy and get psychiatric help every week. So that's the tragic case of Jaya.
This is what a woman had to say after shooting her own son.
I would like to say
something.
Go ahead. I'm innocent. F*** you all. You're garbage.
She had gained custody of her son instead of her husband only 10 days prior. She was arrested after police pulled her over for a traffic violation and found the body in the trunk.
Eli will forever be missed by so many people that loved him. He will forever and always be in our hearts.
Police were unsure whether she killed for the life insurance money or because of mental health reasons.
A Barbie left on the grave of this murdered child might be used to solve her cold case. 6-year-old Rosie Tapia was abducted from her bedroom on August 13, 1995. Her mother had gotten home at 3 a.m. and checked on Rosie in the bedroom that she shared with her siblings. They were all sleeping soundly with the window open, and her mother went to close the window but didn't lock it because the noise would wake the children. Literally just 2 hours later, her mom woke up and got a feeling that she needed to check on her children. Rosie was gone, and her body was later found floating in the nearby canal. Police determined that the screen had been pried off from the outside, and being so low to the ground, an intruder could easily get in. And unfortunately, any DNA on her body was contaminated by the canal water. And after Rosie was buried, the family found a single Barbie doll sitting on her grave. And police are hoping that DNA from the doll could be used to solve the case. Advances in DNA technology give hope that one day Rosie's case can be solved and over 60 people have been swabbed, but no one's been arrested. There are multiple suspects in this case, including a man that was seen walking with wet jeans on the morning of Rosie's death, and this man in the hat and sunglasses that carried Rosie back to her apartment after she hurt herself on the playground the day before she died. I do a deep dive into possible suspects and theories on the murder of Rosie Tapia on my YouTube channel, Celestial Sylvia.
Air Force Major Andre McDonald went on trial for the murder of his wife, Andrine McDonald. His defense attorney called him to the stand to explain what happened. It was the first time he had ever spoken publicly about his wife's death. Andre said that on the night of February 28, 2019, he had raised the possibility of divorce and splitting their million-dollar business in half. His wife, Andrine McDonald, had started an assisted living business in San Antonio, Texas in 2012. According to Andre's close friend, Andrew Russell, Andre bankrolled her dreams.
In order to start the business, Andre, he liquidated his 401k and he sold the BMW that he owned.
Andre testified that hours before Andrine died, he had found out his wife had started a new business in 2018 without his knowledge.
What did that signify to you?
Basically, that meant to me pretty much that she was robbing me.
Andre admitted that an argument ensued and turned physical.
She became extremely irate at the thought of splitting the business, charges into the room to confront me. So when she comes into the room, you know, I turn around and she comes like right up in my face. So at that moment, she spits in my face. So at that point, I grabbed her because she's like right in front of me. So I grabbed her head. I think we had like a clash of heads. And I think it opened up like a cut somewhere on her face.
Andre said Andrine ran into the bathroom and turned on the lights. When Andrine saw her bloody face in the mirror, Andre claimed she attacked him. His testimony may be disturbing to some viewers.
Yeah, so when she comes, she's like throwing like some punches. So I'm trying to like duck down and like keep my head, my face from getting hit with the blows. But I remember like grabbing her and like tripping her, and then she like falls, and that's when I kick her like twice. The second kick, I think I heard like some type of wheezing, and then also, like in the background, I could hear like some footsteps.
The footsteps of their young daughter, Elena. McDonald said he left Andrine on the floor, hurt but alive, to put Elena back to bed. And when he returned about 30 minutes later, his wife was dead.
I became like pretty frantic at that point. Because, you know, she's dead on the floor.
You know. You never thought I need to call EMS.
In cross-examination, Prosecutor Spear asked if Andre had thought about calling 911.
I never thought about calling anybody to revive a dead person. My purpose at that point was simply to get her out of the house so that my 7-year-old daughter wouldn't see her mother laying on the floor dead.
The defense then brought up why Andre acted the way he did that night.
Have you always believed you acted in self-defense?
Yes, I've always believed that from the very beginning.
The defense played videos showing Andrine giving her husband a piggyback ride and working out.
Would you describe Andrine as a very strong, powerful woman?
Yes, I would.
According to Andre, his wife could lift up to 300 pounds.
Yes, ma'am!
When she attacked you, were you in fear?
Yes, I was in fear of, you know, being harmed during that whole situation.
They want you to forget and disregard about all his actions.
It was now up to the jury. The jurors had to decide if Andre McDonald was guilty of murder, manslaughter, or not guilty by self-defense. After almost 11 hours of deliberating, Andrine's family was worried.
Everything was said in the courtroom. All the evidence were there. He confessed on the stand what he did. They saw his demeanor. I don't know what was the problem.
Jurors Brandon Medellin.
I voted for murder, and I saw that we were 6-6.
And Rudy Ruiz.
At no point did any juror think that he was innocent or that it was self-defense.
And yet the jury was deadlocked.
No one was going to change anyone's mind.
The judge urged the jurors to go back and reconsider the evidence and reach a unanimous decision. After another hour of deliberations, a verdict.
Dumbest ways criminals got caught.
In 2012, 17-year-old Cody Connor attempted to rob a retail store in DeBary, Florida at gunpoint. The calm clerk asked him why he was robbing the place, and he said he needed money to help his sick grandparents pay their bills. Instead of giving him the money, the clerk told him they were hiring and convinced him to apply for a job. The teen put away his revolver and sat down to fill out a job application before leaving the establishment. With all of his information in hand, he was quickly arrested. He later pleaded no contest and received 10 years in prison. In 2010, 59-year-old Mark Smith entered a bank in Watsonville, California, and demanded $2,000 in cash. He told the bank employees he had a bomb and would detonate it if they didn't give him the money. Rather than give him what he wanted, a bank teller convinced him to take out a loan. While Smith started filling out the paperwork, bank employees contacted authorities. When police arrived at the bank, they took Smith into custody. He did not have a bomb or any weapons on him. No word on what punishment he received.
Let's talk about what happened to 13-year-old Rachel Mellon Skimp. She was born on October 13th of 1982 and lived in Melrose Park in Illinois. At the age of 3, her parents divorced and her dad moved to Dallas and her mom stayed with her in Illinois. Eventually, her mom started seeing a man named Vincent, and eventually they got married and had 2 children together. Rachel was described as a bubbly person with a great sense of humor. She was the life of the party and was always the most beautiful girl in the room. On January 30th of 1996, Rachel was at school and was having a normal school day, and as the day went on, her friends noticed that she was crying by her locker, so they went to go ask what was wrong. She said she was having a problem, but that she was going to fix it herself, and that is all she said. The following day, on Wednesday, January 31st, Rachel decided to stay home from school because she was having a sore throat and was feeling kind of sick, so her mom left to work, and her stepfather was going to stay home because he wasn't working at the moment. Rachel called her grandma to thank her for the Christmas gifts that she had sent her, and this call took like from 4 to 5 minutes, and her grandma said that this phone call was completely normal, nothing out of the ordinary, but she did notice that at one part in the phone call, Rachel was kind of quiet, and her grandma said, "Is he there?" referring to her stepfather, and she said yes, and then Rachel told her grandmother that she needed to hang up. Her stepfather stated that they played the Nintendo before she decided to go up to her room and take a nap. So once she was upstairs taking a nap, he decided to take the family dog for a walk, even though it was 20 degrees below zero. So he left at 2:30 p.m. and then ended up coming at 3 p.m. He said the reason that he took a while is because the dog broke free from the leash and he was not able to get him, so he just figured that the family dog would just find his way back eventually. At 3:15 p.m., Vincent's youngest daughter comes home and she goes straight to Rachel's room to greet her, and that's when she realizes that Rachel's not even there. So the youngest daughter tells her dad that it seems that Rachel is missing, that she's not even in her room, but he just doesn't seem to care. So once her mom gets home, the youngest daughter tells her that Rachel's missing from her room, so that is when her mom decides to call 911 and report her as missing. Stay tuned for part 2.
Attention all my documentary lovers, bring it all the way in, baby. We have finally reached the month of December, and while it's cold outside and you're probably spending a whole bunch of time with your family, I'm going to share with you guys the top 5 must-watch documentaries for this month. And at this point, you already know we're going to rank them from least must-watch to just turn it on immediately or else. Let's get into it. Starting us off, we have Victim Suspect, and this one can be found on Netflix. This doc is super infuriating, so big trigger warning. It goes into detail about these young girls who come forward reporting that they've been victims of SA, and basically how the police kind of twist their words to make it seem like something that it isn't. You'll definitely learn a lot from this doc, and you'll honestly probably want to start your own petition after watching this. Coming in at number 4, we have Escaping the Twin Flames, and this is the Netflix version, not the Prime one. I already made a separate video detailing all the ins and outs of the Prime version. The Netflix one, yeah, we got to talk about this. Similar to the Amazon Prime one, this Netflix doc follows Jeff and Shalia and their organization, aka their alleged cult, called Twin Flames Universe. Now, what I like about this version is that it really puts a lot of the onus on the victims to share their stories, and they definitely give you a full play-by-play as to what these two are up to, okay? Our Father. This one's also on Netflix, and it goes into detail about this guy, Dr. Klein, and some of the messed up things that he's done. I'm really not trying to spoil anything, but in a few words, he's a fertility doctor, so yeah. Coming up at number two is Berry, the 1982 Alpine Meadows Avalanche. Listen to me, I did not know what to expect when I watched this. I thought I was gonna be learning about the avalanches and what happens in areas that have them, but this documentary is so well done. It tells the story of what happened on one tragic day when an avalanche came down and claimed the lives of some people in Lake Tahoe. I know that description sounds boring, but I'm telling you, this is such a good documentary. Give it a try. Coming in at number one for the December must-watch documentary, Love Has Won. You can't tell by how I'm trying to talk about this. This was probably one of the sickest documentaries I've ever watched. So this three-part docuseries is on HBO Max, and the best way I can summarize this is this woman right here named Amy becomes the leader of her own religious group or alleged cult. This doc goes into the ins and outs of what her religious group was about. You'll see what I'm talking about, because within the first 30 seconds of this docuseries, you're going to be like, what am I watching? What did I get myself into? As always, let me know what you guys think about these docs. Have you seen them? Especially this one. I want to have a deep conversation about this right here. And also, guys, you all know I have an Instagram, right? Make sure you all are following me there, because I'm going to be posting each month's recommendation list in a highlight.